We know now that in the early years of the 20th century, this world was being watched closely by intelligences greater than man's, and yet as mortal as his own. We know now that as human beings busied themselves about their various concerns, they were scrutinized and studied, perhaps almost as narrowly as a man with a microscope might scrutinize the transient creatures that swarm and multiply in a drop of water. With infinite complacence, people went to and fro over the earth about their little affairs, serene in the assurance of their dominion over this small, spinning fragment of solar driftwood, which by chance or design, man has inherited out of the dark mystery of time and space. Yet across an immense ethereal gulf, minds that are to our minds as ours are to the beasts in the jungle, intellects, vast, cool, and unsympathetic, regarded this earth with envious eyes and slowly and surely drew their plans against us. On this particular evening, October 30th, the Crosley Service estimated that 32 million people were listening in on radio.
Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt our program of dance music to bring you a special bulletin from the Intercontinental Radio News. At 20 minutes before 8 Central Time, Professor Farrell of the Mount Jennings Observatory, Chicago, Illinois, reports observing several explosions of incandescent gas occurring at regular intervals on the planet Mars. The spectroscope indicates the gas to be hydrogen and moving toward the Earth with enormous velocity. Professor Pearson of the observatory at Princeton confirms Farrell's observation and describes the phenomenon as, quote, like a jet of blue flame shot from a gun, unquote. Ladies and gentlemen, following on the news given in our bulletin a moment ago, the Government Meteorological Bureau has requested the large observatories of the country to keep an astronomical watch on any further disturbances occurring on the planet Mars. Due to the unusual nature of this occurrence, we have arranged an interview with a noted astronomer, Professor Pearson, who will give us his views on this event. We take you now to Princeton, New Jersey.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Carl Phillips speaking to you from the observatory at Princeton. Professor, may I begin our questions?
At any time, Mr. Phillips.
Professor, would you please tell our radio audience exactly what you see as you observe the planet Mars through your telescope?
Nothing unusual at the moment, Mr. Phillips. A red disk swimming in a blue sea. Transverse stripes across the disk. Quite distinct now because Mars happens to be at the point nearest the Earth, in opposition, as we call it.
In your opinion, what do these transverse stripes signify, Professor Pearson?
Not canals, I can assure you, Mr. Phillips. Although that's the popular conjecture of those who imagine Mars to be inhabited. From a scientific viewpoint, the stripes are merely the result of atmospheric conditions peculiar to the planet.
Then you're quite convinced, as a scientist, that living intelligence as we know it does not exist on Mars?
I'd say the chances against it are 1,000 to 1.
And yet, how do you account for these gas eruptions occurring on the surface of the planet at regular intervals?
Phillips, I cannot account for it.
President?
It's been a long time, Drew.
It's good to see you, Mr. President.
Please, sit down. So what can I do for an old friend?
Straight to the point. I want your authorization.
For what?
A military operation. A few hours ago, that image, the UFO,
crash landed just outside of Chicago, Illinois, after falling out of the sky. If this is what I think it is, Mr. President, I want permission from my team to quarantine this area, make sure this doesn't cause a panic, and handle the situation as it should be.
Are you sure you know what you're doing?
We have everything ready to go, sir. We just need your permission.
All right, but keep it quiet. Careful, smooth, and by the book. We don't want to cause a panic.
Thank you, sir.
Gentlemen, you've got to go. Well, let's hope this goes well.
It's the first time anyone's received contact from my space.
Craig, you know what to do? Take your team in. You know what to do. Good luck.
And hey, Craig.
Sir?
Come back, eh?
I will.
Good afternoon, Tom.
Good afternoon, sir. Early this morning, we had a disturbance with our radio and satellite signals, and what we believed to be a UFO crash landed just outside of Chicago, Illinois.
Crashed?
A few hours ago, many of the same UFOs started breaking up, multiplying, and entering Earth's atmosphere. We have been given permission from the President to monitor this situation. And let's hope that for our sakes, it doesn't turn into an invasion.
This just in. The President has a speech he would like to say about the alien encounter.
My fellow Americans, an incredible and unexpected incident has happened. We have received contact with life from outer space. We must not regard this as an invasion, but a welcome to our civilization in peace.
We now go to reporters covering this event on The Encounters.
Thank you, Marty. So, what do you think about this alien incident?
I think it's really, really scary.
Both the girl ones are really high.
What do you two think about the alien incident?
Well, I'm worried they're gonna probe, or not probe.
So, sir, what do you think about this alien incident?
You knew what? You're all gonna die! My back! And my hair!
Ladies and gentlemen, we are now going to take you to Carl Phillips and Professor Pearson in Grover's Mill, New Jersey.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Carl Phillips again, out at the Wilmot Farm, Grover's Mill, New Jersey. Professor Pearson and myself made the 11 miles from Princeton in 10 minutes. Well, I hardly know where to begin. To paint for you a word picture of a strange scene before my eyes, like something out of a modern Arabian night. Well, I just got here. I haven't had a chance to look around yet. I guess that's it. Yes, I guess that's the thing directly in front of me, half buried in a vast pit. Must have struck with terrific force. The ground is covered with splinters of a tree. It must have struck on its way down. But I can see the object itself doesn't look very much like a meteor. At least not the meteors I've seen. It looks more like a huge cylinder. Has a diameter of, what would you say, Professor Pearson?
What's that?
What would you say, what's the diameter of this?
About 30 yards.
About 30 yards. The metal on the sheath is, well, I've never seen anything like it. The color is sort of yellowish white. It's curious. Spectators now are pressing close to the object in spite of the efforts of the police to keep them back. Getting in front of my line of vision. Just a minute. Something's happening. Ladies and gentlemen, this is terrific. This end of the thing is beginning to flake off. The top is beginning to rotate like a screw, and the thing must be hollow.
He's moving. Keep back there. Keep back there. Keep those men back. Keep those idiots back.
Take off.
Look out there!
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the most terrifying thing I've ever witnessed. Wait a minute. Someone's crawling
someone
out
or
something. I can see turning out of that black hole two luminous discs. The eyes, it might be a face, might be almost... Good heavens, something wriggling out of the shadow like a gray snake. Now it's another one and another one and another one. They look like tentacles to me. Oh, yeah, I can see the thing's body. Now it's large. It's large as a bear. It glistens like wet leather, but that face. Ladies and gentlemen, it's indescribable. I can hardly force myself to keep looking at it. It's so awful. The eyes are black and they gleam like a serpent. The mouth is
That kind of V-shape with saliva dripping from its rimless lips that seem to quiver and pulsate, and the monster or whatever it is can hardly move. It seems weighed down by possibly gravity or something. The thing's rising up now, and the crowd falls back. It seems plenty. Wait a minute, something's happening. Some shape is rising out of the pit. I can make out a small beam of light against a mirror. What's that? There's a jet of flame springing from the mirror, and it leaps right at the advancing men. It strikes them head on. Lords are turning into flames. The whole field's caught up by the woods, the fires, the gas tanks of the automobiles spreading everywhere. Coming this way now, about 20 yards to my right.
Ladies and gentlemen, due to circumstances beyond our control, we are unable to continue the broadcast from Grover's Mill. Evidently, there's some difficulty with our field transmission. However, we will return to that point at the earliest opportunity.
What the... Oh, God!
Phillips! Are you still there, Phillips?
We are now here with a man who appears to be infested by some sort of an alien creature, at least that's what he says. Do you have any comments about that, sir?
Sugar. Also, give me sugar. In water.
Do you have any comments, sir?
Experiencing some technical difficulties.
Mr. President, don't you have a statement?
You fool, we're all gonna die. I have to catch my chopper.
Get the hell out of here, man.
At this time, we take you to Washington for a special broadcast on the national emergency. The Secretary of the Interior.
Citizens of the nation, I shall not try to conceal the gravity of the situation that confronts the country, nor the concern of your government in protecting the lives and property of its people. However, I wish to impress upon you, private citizens and public officials, all of you, the urgent need of calm and resourceful action. Fortunately, this formidable enemy is still confined to a comparatively small area, and we may place our faith in the military forces to keep them there. In the meantime, placing our faith in God, we must continue the performance of our duties, each and every one of us, so that we may confront this destructive adversary with a nation united, courageous, and consecrated to the preservation of human supremacy on this earth. I thank you.
You have just heard the Secretary of the Interior speaking from Washington.
What the hell is that, a lawnmower?
Move for your life! People with lawnmowers just don't mix!
I'm speaking from the roof of Broadcasting Building. I'm speaking from the roof of Broadcasting Building, New York City. The bells you hear are ringing to warn the people to evacuate the city as Martians approach. Estimated in the last 2 hours, 3 million people have moved out along the roads to the north. No more defenses. Our army is wiped out. Artillery, Air Force, everything wiped out. This may be the last broadcast. We'll stay here to the end. Wait a minute. The enemy is now in sight above the Palisades. Five great machines. First one is crossing the river. I can see it from here, wading the Hudson like a man wading through a brook. A bulletin is handed me. Martian cylinders are falling all over the country. One outside of Buffalo, one in Chicago, St. Louis. Seem to be timed and spaced. Now the first machine reaches the shore. He stands watching, looking over the city. Steel cowlish head is even with the skyscrapers. He waits for the others. They rise like a line of new towers on the city's west side. Now they're lifting their metal hands. This is the end now. Smoke comes out, black smoke drifting over the city. People in the streets see it now. They're running toward the East River, thousands of them, dropping in like rats. Now the smoke's spreading faster. It's reached Times Square. People are trying to run away from it, but it's no use. They're falling like flies. Now the smoke's crossing 6th Avenue. 5th Avenue. 100 yards away. It's 50 feet.
Wait a minute. What's that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, sir.
It's not over, gentlemen. The original ship that crashed inside of Chicago, Illinois, is still active, and apparently the species on board has found a way to survive and increase their numbers.
There's a skyscraper right beside the crash site. Reports say that it's been shut down and evacuated. They're hiding there and infesting the place.
Well, all of Chicago's been evacuated, so all that's left to do is plant a plasma bomb. It's about a quarter to a half of the size of a nuclear explosion.
Then nothing living, not even bacteria, will survive. Get dropped 50 minutes in a time, we plan it, and get ready for the 4th of July.
If we die, we cannot take the world with us.
Tom Craig, sir. He's got something on his face. They all do.
So what'd you say happened to those with the things on their face?
Last 24 hours, many have died and many have lived. But these who have died gave their lives to warn us and to save us. That we thought, was a blessing, was actually a curse amongst human nature, a contact of invasion. Many those who saved our lives rest in peace today.